Negotium Perambulans by E.F. Benson. Narrated by Trevor O'Hare. The casual tourist in West Cornwall may just possibly have noticed, as he bowled along over the bare high plateau between Penzance and the Land's End, a dilapidated signpost pointing down a steep lane and bearing on its battered finger the faded inscription, Pullern, 2 miles. But probably very few have had the curiosity to traverse those 2 miles in order to see a place to which their guidebooks award so cursory a notice. It is described there, in a couple of unattractive lines, as a small fishing village with a church of no particular interest except for certain carved and painted wooden panels, originally belonging to an earlier edifice, which form an altar rail. But the church at St. Creed, the tourist is reminded, has a similar decoration far superior in point of preservation and interest, and thus even the ecclesiastically disposed are not lured to Pullern. So meager a bait is scarce worth swallowing, and a glance at the very steep lane, which in dry weather presents a carpet of sharp-pointed stones, and after rain a muddy watercourse, will almost certainly decide him not to expose his motor or his bicycle to risks like these in so sparsely populated a district. Hardly a house has met his eye since he left Penzance, and the possible trundling of a punctured bicycle for half a dozen weary miles seems a high price to pay for the sight of a few painted panels. Pullern, therefore, even in the high noon of the tourist season, is little liable to invasion, and for the rest of the year I do not suppose that a couple of folk a day traverse those 2 miles, long ones at that, of steep and stony gradient. I am not forgetting the postman in this exiguous example, for the days are few when, leaving his pony and cart at the top of the hill, he goes as far as the village, since but a few hundred yards down the lane there stands a large white box, like a sea trunk, by the side of the road, with a slit for letters and a locked door. Should he have in his wallet a registered letter, or be the bearer of a parcel too large for insertion in the square lips of the sea trunk, he must needs trudge down the hill and deliver the troublesome missive, leaving it in person on the owner and receiving some small reward of coin or refreshment for his kindness. But such occasions are rare, and his general routine is to take out of the box such letters as may have been deposited there, and insert in their place such letters as he has brought. These will be called for, perhaps that day or perhaps the next, by an emissary from the Pullern Post Office. As for the fishermen of the place, who, in their export trade, constitute the chief link of movement between Pullern and the outside world, they would not dream of taking their catch up the steep lane and so, with 6 miles farther of travel, to the market at Penzance. The sea route is shorter and easier, and they deliver their wares to the pierhead. Thus, though the sole industry of Pullern is sea fishing, you will get no fish there unless you have bespoken your requirements to one of the fishermen. Back come the trawlers as empty as a haunted house, while their spoils are in the fish train that is speeding to London. Such isolation of a little community, continued, as it has been for centuries, produces isolation in the individual as well, and nowhere will you find greater independence of character than among the people of Pullern. But they are linked together, so it has always seemed to me, by some mysterious comprehension, it is as if they had all been initiated into some ancient rite, inspired and framed by forces invisible and visible. The winter storms that batter the coast, the vernal spell of the spring, the hot, still summers, the season of rains and autumnal decay, have made a spell which, line by line, has been communicated to them, concerning the powers, evil and good, that rule the world and manifest themselves in ways benignant or terrible. I came to Pullern first at the age of 10, a small boy, weak and sickly, and threatened with pulmonary trouble. My father's business kept him in London, while for me, abundance of fresh air and a mild climate were considered essential conditions if I was to grow to manhood. His sister had married the vicar of Pullern, Richard Blitho, himself native to the place, and so it came about that I spent 3 years as a paying guest with my relations. Richard Blitho owned a fine house in the place, which he inhabited in preference to the vicarage, which he let to a young artist, John Evans, on whom the spell of Pullern had fallen, for from year's beginning to year's end he never left it. There was a solid roofed shelter, open on one side to the air, built for me in the garden, and here I lived and slept, passing scarcely 1 hour out of the 24 behind walls and windows. I was out on the bay with the fisherfolk, or wandering along the gorse-clad cliffs that climbed steeply to right and left of the deep combe where the village lay, or pottering about on the pierhead, or birds nesting in the bushes with the boys of the village.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.